Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2024. Excuse my slightly hoarse voice. The first item on our agenda today is to decision on taking items 4 and 5 in private. That relates to the petition 1975, while item 5 relates to the consideration of any content we might be going to hear this morning. So are members content to do that? We are. That brings us to agenda item 2, which is consideration of continued petitions. And the first of those is petition number 1975, reform the law relating to strategic lawsuits against public participation, commonly referred to as SLAPs. This has been lodged by Roger Mullen, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review and amend the law to prevent the use of strategic lawsuits against public participation, which we last considered at our previous meeting on the 17th of April. And at that point, we heard evidence from Professor Justin Borge-Bartlett, Graham Johnston, Roger Mullen, and Ashan Mustafa. And again, can I thank our witnesses from that session and the evidence that they provided to us. And so this morning, after our various considerations, I'm pleased to welcome Siobhan Brown, MSP, the Minister for Victims and Community Safety, Martin Brown, who is a solicitor with the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, and Michael Paparakis, Policy and Bill Programme Manager from the Private Law Unit. And before we move to questions, Minister, I understand you've got a short statement you would like to offer to the committee.
Good morning, and thank you, Convener, for the opportunity to talk about strategic lawsuits against public participation, often referred to as SLAPs. I'd like to thank the petitioner, Roger Mullen, for his tireless work campaigning on this matter. The petition raises some important issues, and it is helpful to have them discussed in this sort of forum. You'll be aware that the Scottish Government recently introduced reforms to our law of defamation, which took steps towards further protecting freedom of expression. While SLAPs are typically framed as defamation cases brought by wealthy individuals or corporations to evade scrutiny in the public interest, they can occur across a broad spectrum of issues, including data protection, privacy, and environmental law. Since Parliament considered the law of defamation, significant steps have been taken elsewhere in the UK and also in the EU. In England and Wales, the UK government has given its support to a private members' bill, which will widen the scope of a limited anti-SLAP legislation already in place. And at the EU level, there is a recent EU directive, and the Council of Europe has recently adopted a recommendation on countering SLAPs. Convener, for those reasons, I think it's important that we make some progress on this issue, and I'm pleased to say that I will consult on SLAPs later this year. It seems to me both timely and sensible to consult on the issue of SLAPs specifically in the context of Scottish law. My officials have already had some helpful engagement with stakeholders, and I will ensure that that continues throughout the process of the consultation. And I welcome any questions that you or the committee members may have.
Well, thank you, Minister. I think that's encouraging. And in fact, I can see the petitioner over your shoulder, actually, in the gallery this morning, who will no doubt be pleased to hear that. I'm interested because I was trying to understand the pathway. And at last week's meeting, having read the previous submissions that we'd received, there was obviously an understanding that Scots law is rooted in different traditions and precedents than law elsewhere in the UK, and that the assumption underpinning the petition that there would be tourist destination travel for this kind of litigation to Scotland was perhaps thought to be more of a theory than necessarily an absolutely determined outcome, and that the Scottish Government's thought process at that point had been that they would prefer to be in a slightly reactive position if it did happen, rather than in a proactive position simply because it might happen, given everything else that the government has to consider. I don't know, was that part of the thinking, or has the fact that there has now been action taken in other jurisdictions almost compounded the potential risk of what might otherwise have been, on a scale of theory, lesser, now more potentially one that could occur, and therefore something that government feels it maybe needs to take more decisive and direct action in relation to, on a proactive rather than a reactive basis.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Convener. I think originally when, it must have been my predecessor, wrote to the committee, when the petition was first lodged to the committee, that it was under review. But as I said in my opening speech, there has been quite a significant development in the last couple of months regarding this legislation, and that's why we think it's quite timely that we move forward with consultation.
Okay, thank you. Well, given that that's the case, I think our questions might be quite focused and to the point, because I don't think we're pushing a stone up a hill in the sense that the government appear to have accepted the argument. But I think it'd be interesting to explore some of the issues underpinning the need for all of this. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and colleagues. Minister, can you outline what discussions have been had at UK-wide anti-slap task force in relation to a non-legislative action against slaps?
Yes, there is a task force that has the UK government, EU, and I know that the officials in Scotland are part of that task force as well. So I think legislation itself would not address all the potential issues that is going to be raised by slaps, and there does need to be more of a holistic approach, and that's why we are working together with the task force in this.
Minister, can I ask what wider monitoring has been carried out in relation to use of the impact of slaps in Scotland?
Yes, I think I might bring in Michael for that question.
Yeah, slaps are, I think you heard a couple of weeks ago, a difficult thing to try and measure. I understand that there is survey work being undertaken by academics at the University of Aberdeen to try and understand the wider picture. But most evidence tends to be anecdotal rather than any quantitative data. We obviously are aware of some of the issues that have been raised by stakeholders, both here at the committee and in general. There were some cases that were presented at a conference, an anti-slap conference here in Scotland, towards in the middle of February. So, you know, we're certainly aware of instances that stakeholders would suggest are slaps, and that is also another reason why the Scottish Government have decided to consult, that, you know, there is a perception that this is currently happening in Scotland, and, you know, we should move things forward.
Thank you. Another question.
Fergus Ewing.
Just pursuing that last question, Convener, I mean, is it not the case that there's no doubt whatsoever that slaps is a huge problem, and that the number of slaps raised, threatened, is enormous? I mean, we've heard this time and time again from evidence, from lawyers that practice in this. I was reading earlier this morning a Graham Henderson submission to the Law Society some years ago, where he referred to the huge number of interdict cases that never come anywhere near court, because the pursuer, the petitioner, usually, of course, the session, is so financially stronger than the defender that they haven't got a cat's chance in hell of affording litigation. That's the whole point. So, I mean, is it not the case that, you know, the government must surely accept that this is a very serious problem, and that you cannot measure it by the number of cases that actually go to court? Because, like an iceberg, you know that most of it is submerged. You cannot exactly measure it, because there's no record of those cases where an oligarch that might own a Russian oil company, or a mine owner from Kazakhstan — I just picked two of the litigations that were quite prominent in the history of slaps. So, I mean, I just want to establish, really, Minister, that you accept this is a very serious problem. And also, could you answer this question? Good news that you've agreed to consult. I think we all recognise that. But this is a very ancient petition. I mean, it's becoming a kind of petitioner's, pensioner of petitioners, really. And, you know, well, I'm a pensioner, so I shouldn't be rude about pensioners. But I mean, it's not really acceptable that things just go on and on and on. So my question to you is this: you know, can you say the government is supportive of taking action, not just that you will do a consultation? And can you say when the consultation paper will be issued? What is your target date? Is it July? Or is it, you know, just vague and sometime never, in which case we might be back here a year, maybe with another minister?
Firstly, yes, we do take it seriously. I think that globally and historically there's been evidence that SLAPS has been an issue. So as I said previously, as we've seen action in Europe and the rest of the UK, it is time for the Scottish Government to act on this. And I take your point that this is an old petition, but we are moving forward. Consultation will happen this autumn. I can't give the specific date at this time, and it will run for 12 weeks, and then we will look at the responses, and then we'll take it from there. I can't premeditate what the Cabinet might suggest regarding legislation, but yes.
Well, I think that's as much, convener, as I could reasonably ask of any minister, so I'm grateful for that. And if you want a very useful form of words to make sure that you're never really in any particular hook as to the timescale within which you do anything, then the legal terminology is we will do it on or around between X. That's
thank you.
Some free advice.
All of which is noted. I mean, I would just point out the petition was first lodged in September 22. I mean, it does make it something of a teenager, I would have said, in our schedule of petitions. If that's a pensioner petition, then some of our petitions are of the Jurassic period by that kind of definition, I suspect, Mr. Ewing.
With greater quantities of patience than me.
Well, that remains to be seen, of course. Thank you, Mr. Ewing. Any other colleagues? Mr. Goldham.
Thanks, convener. I'm just interested in the motivation behind the consultation. Is it a result of this petition? Is it a result of Scottish Government policy to ensure continuity with EU law? Or if you could perhaps explain around
sure,
that.
I think obviously the petition was there when my predecessor did write to the committee that it was always going to be under review and consideration. And just because we have seen definite progress being made by the private members bill going through the UK and the EU just in recent months, this is why we decided we need to take action and we will go to consultation in autumn.
Is the minister concerned about the potential time lag between developments in Scotland and elsewhere and how that could expose Scotland to SLAPS?
Not at the moment. I will keep the committee updated on that, but I do know it's still the early stages in going through the UK Parliament and the EU, so it hasn't actually passed as yet or gone to the House of Lords. So at this stage, I have no concerns.
And do you have an idea about the scope and form of the consultation in terms of what you are looking to bring forward and indeed mirror in terms of the different jurisdictions that have brought forward this type of legislation?
So we will be engaging with all the different jurisdictions that have brought forward legislation and working with stakeholders for the consultation. I don't know, Michael, if there's anything further you'd like to add.
There's no real set information on what the consultation will contain at this time, but there are, as the Minister said, there's the UK legislation, EU directive, and those are items there that are potential, questions could be asked on and for consultation.
Is public education on the issue of SLAPS in the running to be in the scope of the consultation? Is that something you can tell to the committee?
I think it's very worthy of consideration.
Yep. Mr. Yu, one of the points that Mr. Mullen and others made in the evidence session before, and I'm pretty sure the Minister's rightly studied all this, is that the focus of the Scottish Government in responding to the petitioner's arguments has broadly been to refer to the Defamation and Malicious Publication Act, in other words, defamation actions. But I think it was Mr. Mullen who pointed out that this is not the only type of slap, and slaps will cover other types of action, and therefore it would be wrong to assume that only the law of defamation plays. I mean, it probably is the main topic, but it's not the only one. Can the Minister confirm that the consultation will cover that fully?
So yes, that we will be covering every aspect of it, yes.
Just the last question. There was, by I think one of your predecessors, a reference which I thought was really not apt, shall we say, which was to say that, oh well, it doesn't really matter because the cost of pursuing a court action in the Sheriff Court is only £25,000. And you know, argument A is £25,000 is £25,000 more than most people have got to pay for a court action, and therefore most people can't afford that amount. So the idea that such a small sum that people would be able to afford is ludicrous. And number two, actually, almost all these actions will be raised by way of interdicts in the Court of Session anyway. So it's completely irrelevant to look at the cost of the Sheriff Court. Now, I just raise that not to be smart or critical of anybody, but just can I ask if the government kind of accepts that that argument should be pushed to one side? And the costs of Court of Session action are colossal. We're talking hundreds of thousands of pounds. No individual other than millionaires, in fact, multimillionaires, will go to court. And having practiced law for 20 years, I mean, I know that. People will not go to court, even if they think they've got a cast iron defence. And that's the whole point. You know, it doesn't really matter what brilliant defences that are set out, as is the case in Defence and Malicious Publication Act. You know, it was a good piece of legislation in that regard. It created a range of defences and protections, but actually they're no good enough to protect the real mischief here, which Mr. Mullen and his colleagues have clearly pointed out. So I just wanted to kind of put that thesis to the minister, just to try and get some reassurance for the petitioner that the consultation paper won't duck these questions and certainly won't repeat that particular argument.
No, absolutely, and I did see that correspondence with the £25,000 that was previously sent to you, and I think when I spoke to my officials about that, it was sort of in the context of UK-wide litigation, but I have looked at legal aid, and as you know, it could be considered on a case-to-case person if anyone wanted to pursue that way, but totally accept your point and your comments right on that. Yeah,
I think I agree with the first part. The second part, there's no legal aid for defamation.
Well, I've been told that they can, on the board can consider it on a basis.
They can consider it, can
yes.
They? Oh, well,
can
I stand corrected.
Double check, but that's...
I've thought Mr. the chap from the Law Society last session said that there wasn't.
Yeah, the legal aid is on a case-by-case basis and relevant circumstances.
Well, it's still pretty dubious, and, yeah. You know, and most people, you know, won't get legal aid if they've got even a very relatively small amount of capital tied up. So, but in any event, I think your answer's... satisfactory. Thank you, Minister. I haven't said that for a while, actually. So
no.
We can agree. We can agree on that point. And actually, Minister, thank you very much. That's actually, I don't think we need to detain you any longer, that the petitioner's aims, I think, are potentially in hand and potentially able to be resolved. I'm very grateful to you for that and for joining us with your colleagues this morning. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and I'm happy to keep the committee updated as we progress.
I'd be very grateful. Okay. Thank you very much. A brief suspension. Off we go. And welcome back. We continue with our consideration of existing petitions, and they come to petition number 1973, which is to end the use of sheriff's discretion when ruling on civil cases and provide clear legal guidance on the division of assets. Now, this petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the Family Law Scotland Act of 2006, and was lodged by Sandy Isett, and to provide greater clarity on the division of assets in cases of cohabiting couples who are separating by either removing the use of the sheriff's discretion rulings in such cases, civil cases, providing clear legal guidance to the Law Society of Scotland on the division of assets for cohabiting couples, allowing appeals to be heard where it is determined that a sheriff has the rule of law wrong, but have used their discretion to prevent an appeal at no cost to the appellant, and publishing information on what resources have been allocated to provide clear legal guidance. Now, we last considered this petition the 6th of September last, and at that point we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, and we now have received a response from the victim, Minister for Victims and Community Safety, who was just with us, in which she is unable to provide an anticipated timescale for bringing forward a bill on cohabitation. The Minister has confirmed Scottish Government officials are beginning detailed work on the Scottish Law Commission report on cohabitation, including an assessment of whether it would be helpful for the Government to consult on the Commission's recommendations. And we've also received a submission from the petitioner expressing his concern at the vagueness of the information we've received on this issue, and highlighting his continued concern about the use of sheriff discretion in preventing appeals. In the light of the progress of what we've heard, which is that the government will move forward, but they don't know when they will move forward, and the petitioner feeling matters remain a little vague, I wonder what the committee's view is at present. Mr. Torrens?
In light of a response from the Scottish Government, I wonder if a committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government officials have begun detailed work on the Scottish Law Commission's report on cohabitation, which will include an assessment of whether it would be helpful for the Scottish Government to consult on the Commission's recommendations in this area. And the petitioner could always bring the petition back if he's not happy with the findings.
Mr. Ewing?
Just in agreeing with Mr. Torrance's recommendation, could I just reassure the petitioner that I think the point he's raised is an extremely valid one, and I think I may have said before in a previous session, but just repeat for his benefit, given that we are closing the petition today, that the Family Law of Scotland Act 2006, in which I played a part during the proceedings, is extremely vague in relation to the division of the property between the couples, unmarried couples who live together effectively as man and wife, because it doesn't incorporate the very detailed provisions in the Family Law of Scotland Act 85, which applies for divorce. And those very detailed rules contrasted markedly with the complete vacuum of rules in the 2006 Act. And to be fair to myself, I did make a speech to that effect in stage three, saying we do not really know what we do, and we did not provide sufficient clarity. So I just wanted to say, convener, for the sake of the petitioner, any petitioner whose petition is closed will always feel a bit disappointed, but I think he's done a good job in raising an important topic, and I feel slightly uneasy the government hasn't given a clearer commitment, so I hope the government will perhaps bear that in mind, and maybe we could write to them and say that, you know, we feel that this is the case, that there does need to be clarity and perhaps a more specific undertaking as to when the corrective work will be done, whether it's one of the devices that Mr. Izzat has mentioned or by primary legislation, which I suspect will probably be necessary.
Okay. Yes, thank you very much for that, Mr. Ewing. I think that's correct. I think in closing the petition, it is open to us to write to the government saying that we are closing the petition, but we are doing so on the basis of the good faith of the government saying that they are going to progress, but that, you know, it would be helpful to try and tie that down to a more specific timeline. And certainly to Mr. Izzat to say thank you very much for bringing what is an important petition before the committee, and certainly to say to him that in the event no progress is made, then obviously it would be open to him to table a fresh petition. But as matters stand at the moment, I think the committee has taken the issue as far forward as we can, given the government's response and assurance. Are members content to proceed on that basis? We are. Our next petition is coupled, petition number 1974, to adopt the A90, A890 as a trunk road, and petition 1980 to adopt the A832 between Achnasheen and Gorston as a trunk road. This petition, both these petitions have been lodged by Derek Noble, And one call, the first, 1974, calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to adopt the A890 as a trunk road and to resolve the safety problems associated with the Strom Ferry bypass. And Petition 1980 calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to adopt the A832 between Achnacheen and Gorston as a trunk road, connecting this route into the existing trunk road network. Now, we last considered these petitions at our meeting on the 6th of September 2023, and we agreed to write to the Minister of Transport. The Minister, now Cabinet Secretary for Transport, has responded to our request for clarity by stating that the Strategic Transport Projects Review 2 considered local roads to be out of scope of the review unless they provided direct access to a major port or airport linked to a nationally significant national planning framework for development site, or where a local road intersected with a trunk road where bus priority or active travel measures were proposed. The Cabinet Secretary said as it was considered that neither the A890 or the 832 met these criteria, they were not included as part of the appraisal or recommendations for the Strategic Transport Projects Review 2. Now, we've been joined this morning by Rhoda Grant. I think the committee are wrestling with a fairly direct response to the aims of the petition from the Cabinet Secretary, Rhoda Grant, but the committee would be very happy to hear anything you might like to say.
I'm really grateful to the committee for giving me the opportunity to speak, and I'm grateful to Derek Noble for pursuing this through the petition. And I share the committee's disappointment at the response received from the Cabinet Secretary, because it really just is what they said before. They don't take any notice of the fact that the residents on the other side of the Strome Ferry bypass, which is the major issue on that road, need to cross that bypass for hospital care, for secondary education, for the economy of the area. And this really cuts off the economy of the area, because the alternative route takes 6 hours. You know, that's longer. You would get to Glasgow and Edinburgh sooner than you would get to your local hospital. It's 130 miles detour. You basically have to go all the way back to the East Coast to come back west again. So it's so disappointing, because this seems to be, despite the evidence that is there, the Scottish Government just seemed to be saying no, and there's no right of appeal. And in a way, adding insult to injury, they talk about, you know, priority bus routes and cycle lanes. Well, there are no buses other than the school buses. And the cycle lane would take up the total width of the road. So there is no option to put those things in place. And, you know, money is available for that, but the very basics, there is no money available for. I've got some figures from 2017. I mean, the costs varied then from 37 million to 129 million. Now, with Spice's inflator, that would be 46 million to 159 million. But we know that the costs of roads, the inflation is much greater than that. So, that, you know, even if you were taking the 159 million, Highland Council received this year 33.6 million for capital. How many years of their full capital allocation would it take for them to fix this road? So it's absolutely unfeasible. The Scottish Government response has basically said to those communities, tough. Highland Council can't afford to do this because we don't fund them adequately, and we're washing our hands of the whole situation. And really, that's not a sustainable position. So I'm asking the committee not to let this petition close, but maybe look at another option to appeal to the Scottish Government to work with Highland Council to try and find a funding option that would allow this road to be improved, because it will take Scottish Government to provide that funding or ways of accessing that funding to Highland Council. But they also might want to involve Network Rail, because we talk about the road, but the rail line is just beside the road. So the road has saved the rail line to an extent in the last major rock falls. In fact, the rail line was used as a temporary road for part of that to stop the long detour. But if government are washing their hands of this. It's only a matter of time when there's going to be a big rock fall, that road will close, and then there'll be nothing to protect the rail line. So we could be looking at losing both road and rail connections. And I don't know if the committee has spoken to Network Rail to see if they have similar concerns. Could that help with some of the capital funding? Highland Council provides some capital funding. I know they're struggling at the moment, but Scottish Government and Network Rail, if all three bodies couldn't look at it, because if we're looking at Highland Council to do it, it would take their capital funding for the best part of a decade to sort this out, and that's just not going to happen.
Thank you, Rhoda Grant. I mean, I think you make a very powerful case in respect of the petitioner and the aims of the petition. The question the committee has to wrestle with is the, as you've said, profoundly disappointing but closed door presented to us by the Scottish Government. Mr. Ewing, were you indicating that you had any thoughts on the matter?
Well, I don't think there's really anything further specific we can do. I mean, I think I much sympathy with the points that Rhoda Grant has made about the practical difficulties facing Highland people in general, and that there hasn't been any suggestion of a solution. Personally, I'm not sure that Network Rail are likely to provide any answer here, although I'm sure Rhoda can take that up with them. But I think perhaps our experience in writing to Network Rail is that you do so more in hope than expectation, simply because their budget is committed for a long period in advance in respect of existing programmes, as is the Rose budget. So I don't really see that there's much option, much more the committee can do, convener, rather than to close the petitions under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has said that there are no current plans to undertake a formal review of the trunk road network. The Scottish Government does not consider that the A90 and the A832 meet the criteria for incorporation into the strategic motorway and trunk road networks, with local roads considered being out of scope, unless they provide direct access to a major airport or link to a nationally significant NPF4 development site. The local road intersects with the trunk road where bus priority of active travel measures were proposed, and it's the view that the principal A-class roads are best managed locally rather than centrally, and that the A90 and the A832 belong in this category as main roads which distribute traffic to and from the strategic road network. And that, I'm merely stating the Scottish Government's position, not my own view, which is that we need to do far more, as Rhoda Grant has rightly said today, and that perhaps other methods of funding should be considered. And I do agree with that. Just last comment I make is, maybe in the light of the departure of two ministers from office last week, overall priorities with regard to expenditure of the £60 billion that we have in Scotland to spend could be done, so that more of it is applied to upgrading roads. After all, unless you're a Tour de France cyclist, active travel on a bike isn't really much use for the situations that Rhoda Grant has described. But that's perhaps a topic for another day, convener.
I wonder, Mr. Chowdhury.
I think it is a powerful presentation from Rhoda Grant. I mean, can you not ask the Scottish Government if they will work with the local authorities? Because if that is going to take that many hours, and can you not suggest a visit on the area for the committee?
What I was going to suggest is that if we take forward Mr. Ewing's proposal to close the petition, could we couple that by agreeing that we will write to the Scottish Government in confirming that we are closing the petition, nonetheless summarising the practical consequences that I think Rhoda Grant detailed quite accurately, and also encouraging the Scottish Government to pursue the option or the consideration of an option whereby it might be possible for them to bring together parties who could advance some sort of solution on a bespoke basis, rather than simply, as they've said to us, refusing to entertain any further consideration of the idea. I mean, could we couple that? I mean, I don't think there's any dramatic action that we could take, but we could embrace the suggestion of Rhoda Grant, I think, and write to the government at the same time. Would that meet with the committee's approval? It does.
We close the petition, we're leaving government just to say it's done, it's closed, so we're not leaving them any option. to look at the possibilities of working with the council or coming up with any other solutions.
Well, except I feel really the government have given us very clear direction on their position, and we have as a committee obviously got to be satisfied we've got a realistic opportunity of advancing matters. I'm not persuaded that we have, but I think that we will have Rhoda Grant's testimony of the consequences of that on the record of the official minute of the Parliament. And I think the fact that the committee is prepared to unanimously summarise that view and express it to the government with the hope that they might take more, might take further action, is not our normal way of doing these things. So it is putting in place, by exception, a consequential action. I don't find it easy, but I mean, I just find that we're kind of, with the volume of petitions we've obviously got to consider, we have to be satisfied we've got real prospect of advancing, and we've got other ones where, you know, as you know, even Rhoda Grant is concerned with too, where there may be greater prospect. I mean, I think the circumstances are appalling, but, and I want to thank Derek Noble as well for bringing the petitions before us, and obviously it's, we will see if anything at all comes of that, but I regrettably feel that's the position that we're in. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Yeah, well, that is the position. Thank you very much. We move to petition number 2019, which is to withdraw rates relief under the Small Business Bonus Scheme for Holiday Let Accommodation, lodged by Alan McLeod, calling on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to prevent all owners of small catering holiday accommodation from obtaining rates relief under the Small Business Bonus Scheme. We last considered this petition on the 28th of June last, when we agreed to write to Scottish Assessors, the Holiday Home Association, the Association of Scotland's Self-Caterers and the Scottish Government. And we asked the Scottish Government whether it will consider adding self-catering holiday accommodation to the list of properties that are unable to qualify for the Small Business Bonus Scheme. The response outlines the current arrangements for self-catering holiday accommodation, but does not provide any indication of the Scottish Government's position on the petition. The submission notes that a consultation and council tax for second and empty homes invited views on the thresholds which apply for self-catering accommodation to be liable for non-domestic rates, and the responses were being analysed at the time of the submission. I have to say to the committee, I'm very disappointed with the government's response. I mean, what is the point in sending us a response which is actually almost like a public information leaflet, but doesn't address in any way, positively or negatively, the actual ask of the petition and the question that we put. And I would therefore really like to go back quite directly to the government and say that, you know, the committee doesn't appreciate at all just receiving a statement that we can avail of, which we can reasonably download from the internet ourselves. We are asking about an instrument of future policy relating to the ask of the petition, and that, you know, we would appreciate the government's actual views on the petition as put. Mr. Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. I would endorse everything that you've said. There is nothing there to say that we are for or against the petition.
No.
And we are left in limbo, so I think we should definitely go back to government and ask him one way or another, do you support the petition or do you not, and why?
Yeah. We would much prefer that to a cut and paste from the internet. Thank you. Petition number 2020 to provide fertility treatment to single women, and this is lodged by Anne-Marie Morrison, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide the same fertility treatment to single women as is offered to couples on the NHS for the chance to have a family. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 28th of June, several petitions coming back from that date, when we agreed to write to the Fertility Network Scotland, the British Fertility Society, Fertility Scotland, and the National Fertility Group. The National Fertility Group responded to the committee in October, informing us that at its last meeting, which took place in late August 23, the group received an update from Public Health Scotland on the modelling work they are carrying out to help the group better understand the capacity implications of any future expansion of NHS IVF treatment for single people. Specific timetables for the completion of this modelling work or subsequent consideration could not be given at the time of the group's submission. Now, the petitioner has provided a written submission in which she highlights the support for petitions like hers across the wider UK. She describes the inability of a single person to access fertility treatment on the NHS in Scotland as biased and discriminatory. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider, in light of evidence, writing to the National Fraternity Group to seek a further update on its consideration of the capacity implications of any future expansion of access to NHS IVF for single women, and to ask how it can consider expanding the criteria of intrauterine insemination to single people.
I agree. And we could also just write to Public Health Scotland seeking an update in its modelling work on the timescales that they anticipate for completion. So I think we keep this petition open and seek to get some sort of further explanation of what progress is being made in regard to this. I mean, it all looks a little bit kind of piecemeal and of secondary consideration, but women in Scotland should not feel that they are biased or discriminated against compared to those elsewhere in the United Kingdom. Are colleagues content to proceed on that basis? We are, thank you. Now, my voice has been a little bit shaky this morning and I have a lot to say now about sheep. So do bear with me. Our next petition 2021, ensure the definition of protected animals in the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006 applies to the sheep on St Kilda. This is our next petition. It is lodged by David Peter Buckland and Graham Charlesworth, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to clarify the definition of protected animals contained in the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006 and associated guidance to ensure the feral sheep on St Kilda are covered by this legislation, enabling interventions to reduce the risk of winter starvation and the consequential suffering of the sheep. Now, we last considered this petition as well at our meeting on the 28th of June last, when we agreed to write to the National Trust for Scotland, the St Kilda Soy Sheep Research Project, Nature Scot and One Kind. And I'm pleased to say we've received responses from all of those organisations, copies of which were included for colleagues in our papers for today's meeting. Now, the animal welfare charity One Kind have expressed concern for the welfare of the sheep in St Kilda and suggest that, if necessary, to clarify the status of the sheep in order to establish what level of protection they be afforded and by whom. One Kind's response also suggests, given there is no option for the sheep population to disperse, that there is moral obligation to address the high levels of winter starvation. They do, however, caution that any proposals to reduce levels of winter starvation should be subject to animal welfare impact assessments. Researchers from the Soy Sheep Protect Project state there is no clear biological evidence that the sheep are meaningfully different to other wild mammal populations, and go on to note that wild animals often die in large numbers as a result of natural processes, including starvation and exposure to harsh weather. But in most cases, these deaths are unseen. The researchers also suggest that measures to manage winter mortality, for example, through a large-scale regular cull, could create welfare implications for the remaining sheep. The response from the National Trust for Scotland, where they highlight that the retention of wild traits in the soy sheep population have allowed for their survival in the often harsh conditions of the archipelago, the Trust follow Scottish Government advice, which is that the sheep are regarded in the same way as unowned and unmanaged animal populations such as wild deer. While there is a presumption against intervention, the Trust do note that in exceptional circumstances they may consider intervention in response to animal welfare. While Nature Scot's remit does not specifically cover animal welfare, its response notes that any change to the guidance on the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006 would likely also apply to feral goats and feral cats, potentially leading to unintended consequences if landowners decided to remove populations of feral livestock on their land rather than taking on the burden of their welfare. So that was the response from the organisations to whom we wrote. We've also received two submissions from the petitioners, the first of which addresses the responses we have received and to which I've just referred, and notes the importance of clarifying whether soy sheep are to be considered wild or feral. The petitioners also draw comparison with the winter starvation of cattle and horses in Oostvaar den Plassen in the Netherlands, where, similar to the situation on St Kilda, the feral animals had no predators and could not disperse and obviously could not migrate. In this case, images of starving animals led to public outrage and welfare interventions were rapidly introduced. And then again, the petitioner's most recent submission actually disputes the validity of the information provided to us by the National Trust of Scotland and invites us to request sight of the correspondence between the Trust and the Scottish Government in relation to the status of the soy sheep. In addition, we've also received a submission from Dr. Mary Harmon offering further information on the history of the sheep in St Kilda, noting accounts from the archipelago's inhabitants of the sheep being used for food and suggesting that a number of ram lambs would have been castrated to reduce rams fighting as well as limiting the population. So, a fairly comprehensive set of responses, notwithstanding a challenging additional set of responses from the petitioner on a major issue of wildlife conservation and concern on St Kilda. And I wonder, in the light of all of that, whether members have any comments or suggestions for action. Mr Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider in keeping the petition open and writing to the Scottish Government to highlight the evidence the committee has received and to ask whether it will receive review of existing legislation and guidance and consider using the provision of the Animal Health and Welfare Act, Scotland Act 2006, to introduce regulations and update guidance to ensure the welfare of the unique sheep population on St Kilda. I wonder if we could also request the Scottish Government to provide a full text of its June 2009 communications with the National Trust of Scotland, or clearly set out the reasons for not releasing the correspondence in full.
And I think that seems very sensible and consistent with the suggestions made by the petitioner himself. Are members of the committee content? We will keep the petition open and proceed with it on that basis. I'm not sure if the petitioner is with us today. I wondered if I recognised, he is with us in the gallery, I wondered if I recognised you earlier on. Forgive my eyesight, you're about as far away from me as it's possible to be, but I thought you might be. Well, I hope you'll be pleased then that we've decided to keep the petition open. And in the light of your responses, we'll be pursuing the suggestions that you have made. That brings us to item three on the agenda this morning, which is the consideration of new petitions. And as always, before we move to new petitions, because I realise there may be people who have tuned in to watch our proceedings for the first time to hear how their commission might proceed or be with us in the gallery, I indicate that before we consider a petition, we take two immediate actions in advance. One is to seek a response, an indicative initial response to the petition from the Scottish Government. And the second is to seek a briefing on the issues raised by the petition with the Parliament's independent research body, SPICE. And we do that because, as a veteran of this committee from previous sessions, before we opted to do that, we would meet to consider a new petition and we would do that. That would be the first two things we would recommend that we then do. And all it did was delay our consideration. So we therefore move to petition number 2074, which is to increase local government funding to help protect the vulnerable elderly population and to prevent the closure of care homes. This has been lodged by Iona Stoddart, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase the funding it provides to local councils, enabling them to deliver the best possible health and social care and to help to protect the vulnerable, frail and elderly population from the closure of residential and nursing care homes. Ms Stoddart draws our attention to research suggesting that as many as one care home every week is closing, in part due to cuts in health and social care budgets. This petition has also been prompted by proposals to close two local authority-run care homes in South Lanarkshire. It is perhaps worth noting that since the petition was lodged, South Lanarkshire Integration Joint Board has passed plans to close both care homes. However, it has also written to the Scottish Government in an attempt to secure funding that would enable the closures to be considered. The SPICE briefing notes it is the responsibility of individual local authorities to allocate funding provided by the Scottish Government based on local needs and priorities. The briefing also notes the annual overview of local government in Scotland published by the Accounts Commission. The 23 overview includes reference to the UK-wide survey by the Society of Local Authority Chief Executives, And this found that 44% of respondents identified adult social care as at risk of cuts. And I think any MSP is currently aware of the pressures on all HSPCs within their constituencies and the very particular cuts that are currently being imposed unless care is at the critical or essential definition. The Minister for Local Government, Empowerment and Planning has responded to the petition, stating that it's not a matter for the Scottish Government can intervene in, and that it is up to each democratically elected council how it manages the spending of discretionary budget allocations. In doing so, the Minister notes, and I quote her, I quote the Minister's words, record funding of over £13.9 billion being delivered as part of the latest local government settlement. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? I mean, I'm minded to say myself that I'm encouraged to write to the Minister for Local Government, Empowerment and Planning to seek his reflections on the UK-wide survey by the Society of Local Authority Chief Executives, which found that 44% of council chief executives and senior managers identified adult social care as a service at risk of cuts due to very large gaps in local government budgets. I mean, I'm not prepared, I don't think, just to dismiss the issues of this new petition under the carpet, just on the back of what we've heard from the government so far. I mean, I suspect even since the petition was lodged, the position has deteriorated. Do colleagues have any views?
I would agree.
Members are content? Well, we'll keep thank the petitioner and we will pursue the aims of the petition accordingly. Our next petition is petition number 2075 to prioritise local participation in planning decisions. And it's lodged by Stuart Noble on behalf of Helensburgh Community Council, who may be with us in the gallery today. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to welcome. The Scottish Parliament petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to prioritise local participation in planning decisions affecting their area by providing a clear and unambiguous definition of the word local insofar as it applies to planning legislation, giving decision-making powers to community councils for planning applications in their local areas, and ensuring that the way in which decisions and planning applications are taken is compatible with the provisions and ethos of the Community Empowerment Act of 2015. In the background information to the petition, Helensburgh Community Council highlight the example of planning applications affecting Helensburgh being passed despite opposition from the Community Council and a majority of local ward councillors on the Planning Committee. The SPICE briefing, to which I referred a moment ago, sets out the process for determining planning applications, including the requirement for planning authorities to provide community councils with a weekly list of applications for developments in or within their areas. A planning authority must also consult community councils on proposed developments that are likely to affect the amenity of their area. In its response to the petition, the Scottish Government notes the consultation that has taken place on effective community engagement in local development planning guidance, as well as recent amendments introduced through the Planning Scotland Act 2019 to increase the opportunities for individuals and community bodies to engage in the planning process, including by preparing local place plans for their own areas. The Scottish Government have also suggested that extending powers to determine planning applications to community councils would require comprehensive revisions to existing legislation, with the Government not minded to consider such a fundamental change to the planning system at this time. We have received a submission from the petitioner in response to the Scottish Government and expressing concern that references to engagement, I quote engagement, and participation, again in quotes, are simply box-ticking exercises. The petitioner has also clarified that their proposal will prefer for providing community councils with decision-making powers and planning decisions would be for a number of community councillors to become members of local authority planning committees with full voting powers to assist in determining planning applications within their area. And we are joined this morning by Jackie Bailey, again, in relation to a petition of interest to her community and constituents. And I'm very happy to invite Jackie Bailey to address the committee.
Thank you very much, convener, and thank you to the committee for the opportunity of speaking this morning. I share many of the petitioners' frustrations, and it is, I think, this petition born out of frustration, given that they have attempted to engage really meaningfully with the planning system within Argyll and Bute, sometimes to little notable effect. And the thing that they noted in the petition, which struck me as entirely useful in terms of context here, is actually Helensburgh is closer to Edinburgh than it is to many other parts of Argyll and Bute. Argyll and Bute, as members will know, being very rural and having something like 20-odd islands that are there as well. So, you know, it's not without its challenges. And what they've experienced is very reasonable suggestions that they've made being considered by committees of councillors who simply do not have any relationship or understanding of the community of Helensburgh. They are often councillors who will represent rural areas, island areas. Helensburgh is predominantly an urban population whose travel to work area is in Greater Glasgow. So there's a different context that exists there. But let me give you some of the examples where the community council have engaged, and that engagement has resulted in absolutely nothing happening. And in all of the examples I'm going to give you, the Community Council didn't oppose the application. They suggested a different way of doing it or some conditions that should be applied based on their local knowledge. So in the first case, housing on the former Arden Capel Garden Centre site, the Community Council was very clear that housing could go ahead there, but it was the number of houses that was well in excess of the number specified in the local development plan. So that was a case of, yes, by all means, put houses there, but not in the quantity that they were being squeezed into what was a very tight site. Second example is a care home, which is in the former works depot of Hermitage Park. And again, one of their concerns was the scale of the development, which might have impacted on a war memorial that was right next door to the development. The third example is the leisure centre, which is a beautiful leisure centre, but it's on the pier at Helensburgh on infilled land, which is prone to flooding. And therefore their very eminently sensible suggestion of moving it away from that area was completely dismissed. So the petitioners are not proposing that community councils take all of this over, but that their local knowledge is inserted somehow into the planning system so we get better decisions that aren't about stopping development but are about making sure development is right for the right place in their community. So, I mean, I wonder, I'm sure the committee will have ideas, but writing to the Royal Town Planning Institute might be an option, or indeed Planning Aid, who will have experience of these types of applications. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. So a suggestion to write to the Royal Town Planning Institute. Do colleagues have any other suggestions to make? David Torrance.
Thank you. It's good to see Jackie Bailey back at the committee again. Can I suggest that the committee writes to Royal Town Planning Institute, heads of Planning Scotland, Planning Democracy, Built Environment Forum Scotland and Scottish Forum of Community Councils to seek the views on the actions called for in the petition? And I wonder if a committee would also consider writing to the Scottish Government seeking an update on the progress to finalise the guidance on effective community engagement in the local development planning process.
So I think we have suggestions there. Our committee members agreed. We are agreed. So we'll thank the petitioner, we'll keep the petition open, and we will now embark upon our quest to receive further comment and evidence. Thank you very much, Jackie Bailey, as well. That brings us to petition number 2076, to require original wills made outside of Scotland to be accepted into safe custody by Registers of Scotland or other safe custody providers without prior mailing around. This has been lodged by Maurice Frank, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce legislation to require that custody providers accept original wills from the outset, removing their power first to require an opinion on the validity of the will from a lawyer in the jurisdiction of origin. The Spice briefing explains that prior to a person's death, there is no requirement in Scotland to register a will with a public body. However, a person might choose to register their will for safekeeping in the Register of Deeds. A document whose formal validity is governed by a law other than Scots law can be registered if the keeper is satisfied that the document is formally valid according to the law governing such validity, and the Requirements of Writing Scotland Act 1995 makes this provision. The Scottish Government's response to the petition states that due to the resources involved in obtaining such confirmation, the responsibility for providing the necessary evidence test rests with the applicant. The provision is consistent with the principle that as the Register of Deeds is a Scottish public register, members of the public in Scotland who are not familiar with the laws governing documents in other jurisdictions should be able to view the register with confidence that the documents registered therein are formally valid. Where an individual chooses to lodge a will in the register, it may be possible for evidence to be obtained electronically rather than mailing the document to the relevant jurisdiction, depending on the requirements of that jurisdiction. So quite a technical request and quite a technical response. Do members have any suggestions or comments? Mr. Ewing.
yes, I would suggest that in view of the detailed and helpful response that we've had from the Scottish Government of the 22nd January 24 Civil Law and Legal System Division, and I suspect aided and abetted by the Keeper, that we should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that, of three bases, that first, the requirement to validate documents is because the Register of Deeds is a Scottish public register, and so members of the public in Scotland who may not be familiar with the laws governing documents in other jurisdictions should be able to view the register with confidence that the documents registered therein are valid. Secondly, where an individual chooses to lodge a will in the Register of Deeds, the requirement to confirm the document's validity does lie with the applicant. And third and finally, that it may be possible for confirmation of validity to be obtained electronically rather than posting the physical documents to the relevant jurisdiction, which I think deals, to be fair, with the point that the petitioner quite reasonably raised initially as to what happens if original documents get lost in the post. So that's the recommendation I would make to the committee convener. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. I think given the kind of technical nature of the issue and the responses that we've received, and as you say, the quite helpful summary of procedure from the government, which in part addresses the aims of the petition and the question of the petitioner, Mr. Ewing has proposed that we close the petition on that basis. Are members content? We are. So we thank the petitioner for raising the issue, and I hope that they have drawn some comfort from the response of the government. Petition number 2077, to update curriculum for excellence to remove personal and social education, very often referred to as PSE, from secondary schools, lodged by Thomas Ross. And it calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to remove PSE from curriculum for excellence and for it to stop being taught in secondary schools. The petitioner notes that, in their view, PSE is a useless subject which takes up learning time of secondary school pupils. And now, the Spice briefing notes that health and wellbeing is a key area of the curriculum for excellence, with PSE one of the ways in which schools support the health and wellbeing curriculum. And PSE lessons can cover aspects of planning for choices and changes, substance misuse, relationships, sexual health and parenthood, financial literacy, as well as aspects of physical activity, sport and health. In her response, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills notes that PSE offers an opportunity to ensure children and young people are prepared for the issues and challenges life may bring, with the Scottish Government having, and this is the key point, no plans to remove PSE from the national curriculum. The Cabinet Secretary also highlights the 2017 report from the Education and Skills Committee, which noted how valuable good PSE is to young people, with the Scottish Government continuing to take forward the recommendations of that report. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. In light of the Government's response, I wonder if the Committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has no plans to remove personal and social education from the curriculum. The Scottish Government is continuing to take forward the recommendations of the Education and Skills Committee 2007 review of personal and social education, and views personal and social education as an opportunity to ensure children and young people are prepared for the issues and challenges lying in front of them.
Thank you, Mr. Torrens. Could I suggest, in addition to that, I mean, the Cabinet Secretary refers to the 2017 Education and Skills Committee report, which noted how valuable good PSE is to young people. And I think therein rests an issue of how contemporary the actual content of PSE is at any given point in time. I certainly know from constituents of my own that there is a feeling at times that it's not been updated regularly enough to reflect current circumstances, and that the range of cultural and social issues affecting young people move apace, and that what might have been relevant even 2 or 3 years ago needs to be looked at again. And therefore, while the value of good PSE is there to be seen, it shouldn't be that students question the value of the item in the curriculum, because they should feel that the content of that item in the curriculum is relevant to their concerns and considerations, and not speaking perhaps to something which is aged in terms of their own personal experience. Would members be content that we proceed on that basis?
Agreed.
We are. Thank you. We are going to close this petition on the basis that the government have no plans to do away with the subject. But I think there's an issue at the heart of what you've said about the contemporary relevance of the subject at any given point, and we will draw that to the government's attention. That brings us to petition number 2078 to introduce mandatory licensing and inspection of private ambulance service providers, lodged by Ryan McNaughton. It's the last of our new petitions today, and it calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create a new body responsible for the inspection, assessment and licensing of private ambulance service providers, or to encompass the clinical governance management of private companies in Scotland into Healthcare Improvement Scotland. The SPICE briefing we've received explains that the Public Services Reform Scotland Act of 2010 includes independent ambulance services in the definition of independent healthcare service. The Act sets out that Scottish ministers may prepare and publish standards and outcomes applicable to independent healthcare services, and that Healthcare Improvement Scotland, HIS, may inspect any independent healthcare service. However, HIS has confirmed that at present, regulation of these has not been commenced, and it is unable to undertake any regulatory activity in respect of this type of service. The Scottish Government's response to the petition states that the immediate next step is for officials to continue to engage with stakeholders to explore whether the definition of independent ambulance services should be amended before the provision is commenced, in order to ensure any regulation adequately reflects today's reflects services today and potentially in the future. The response also states that the commencement of HIS's functions in relation to the regulation of independent ambulance service provision will be considered and prioritised as part of a suite of proposals regarding the regulation of independent healthcare. So it seems the Act was passed in 2010, but we've not quite yet commenced the provisions of the Act, which is certainly some lead time by any standard. Do colleagues and members have any suggestions for action? Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to a Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care to ask how, in the absence of regulation, he can be assured that independent ambulances are operating safely. How long does he expect it will take to explore and, if necessary, update the definition of an independent ambulance service? How will the regulation of independent ambulance services be prioritised to suit the proposals for regulations of healthcare? And for details, including a timeline for the commencement of Healthcare Improvement Scotland functions in relation to regulation of independent ambulance service provision. And lastly, why, after making provision for regulations of independent ambulance service in the Public Service Reform Scotland Act 2010, has the Scottish Government decided not to commence the relevant provisions to ensure at least some regulations while additional exploratory work is being undertaken?
Are members content? We are content, so we will keep the petition open and proceed on that basis. That concludes the public part of our meeting today, and we'll meet unusually next Wednesday, when we'll be taking evidence from the former First Minister, Alex Salmond, on the A9 duelling project.
Can I just ask, Convener, if I know we're due to take evidence from Nicola Sturgeon a bit later, I think from memory, some weeks in towards the end of May. Is that? Do we have any information as to whether she's indicated that she's still planning to be able to attend on that date?
We've had no suggestion that that session would not be taking place.
Good. I just asked that because I think she did cancel an engagement to give evidence elsewhere.
In London, yes. But no, we've had no suggestion to that effect at this point. And therefore, we now move into private session.